It's becoming a lot harder these days to tell what's real and what's not on the internet, for me at least. Do you have the same problem? Well, I'm Chan Yuim, and this is Ong Sizi. She's from HTX, and today we're answering your questions about deepfakes. Tell us a bit more about deepfakes. What are they?
Deepfakes are digitally altered video or audio content that is manipulated to look or sound like someone else. So for example, there are deepfake scams out there of political office holders or celebrities. They are also used in pornographic images or video content as well.
What are some telltale signs of deepfakes and how do we identify deepfakes?
For video deepfakes, there are typically three types of telltale signs. So for example, the first one would be excessive blurring or inconsistencies around the facial boundary region. The second one would be inconsistent skin tone or lighting around a person's face compared to other regions of the face or the surrounding conditions. And the last telltale sign for video deepfakes would be desynchronization between the audio and the video of the person's speech. So for audio deepfakes, some of the telltale signs include lack of natural pauses in the person's speech or a more monotonous way of speaking.
I am not Morgan Freeman, and what you see is not real. Well, at least in contemporary terms, it is not.
Who cares? Well, that's a really good question, because why does the average person need to care about deepfakes?
Deepfakes can be used for really malicious intents or use cases. So for example, recently we've seen investment scams out there of our political office holders asking people to invest money in various types of investments that does not even exist. They're also being used to spread misinformation and fake news, which can be really dangerous in this day and age where a lot of people consume online or social media content.
Recently, there's been news where pornographic deepfakes of girls have been circulating on Telegram. What are the implications of this?
I think these are really dangerous because it causes very bad reputation damage to these girls, not just on Telegram per se, but also on other websites where they can be published as well. It's a very widespread problem, not just in Singapore, but also all around the world as well. In fact, pornographic videos are actually one of the highest proportion of deepfake videos up there.
How easy is it to make a deepfake?
Nowadays, one image of the person is definitely enough to make a face swap video, where you simply swap one person's image onto a video that you want to make the video. There are also other types of deepfake videos called lip sync videos.
Hello, my name is Taylor Swift.
Hi, I am George Clooney.
Essentially, you will need the entire video as well as an altered audio content to make the deepfake.
And help me understand, how quickly can a person create a deepfake video these days?
Very quickly. You can do it in less than 30 seconds, depending on the length of the duration of the video or the audio that you're trying to generate. So if you're talking about, let's say, a 10-second clip, you can definitely do it in less than 30 seconds.
What can I do to secure myself against hackers creating deepfakes of myself? Essentially, how do I prevent myself from becoming a deepfake victim?
I think increasingly in this day and age where there's a lot of content being posted on social media, I would say it's very difficult. Unless people don't post anything on social media or share your content, be it your video, your image, or your audio of yourself.
What if my account is private? What happens then?
I think even if the account of the social media is private, there are certain times where it can still be accessed by public, be it on Facebook, for example, or it can also be accessed through the channels of your circle of friends as well.
What happens to my data when I upload a picture? What's the danger in that?
I think the danger to that in using these commercial or proprietary apps is that sometimes the data that you upload will actually be stored in the servers of these providers as well. So I think it's really important to read the fine print of the terms and conditions on how they deal with the data as well as the data privacy policy.
No, I've done it before. I've uploaded so many pictures. I can't get it back.
No.
It's theirs forever.
Yes.
Oh no, I'm in trouble. Are there any laws or regulations against it? Why not just ban deepfakes? Can that be done?
Well, in Singapore, there are definitely laws against spreading misinformation. So for example, POFMA is one of them. But to the second question on why not just ban it, I think deepfakes, like just any AI or technology, is like a double-edged sword. They can be used for good use cases in the business, entertainment, and healthcare industry, but they can also be used by malicious actors to spread fake news, scams as well. So it's definitely very difficult to put out a straight blanket ban for this type of technology that can be used for good as well.
You talked a lot about all the bad use cases and then you mentioned the good ones. Could you give us specific examples of the good use cases?
For example, in the healthcare industry, one of the actors in Top Gun, if I'm not wrong, Val Kilmer, I think he lost his voice due to throat cancer So what they did was they actually used past recordings of him to create deepfake audio such that in some of his future recordings, they can actually give him back his voice as well.
Now, how do we know whether a source is legitimate or not?
I think nowadays there's this technology called invisible watermarking that certain content providers are exploring on the idea of providing content provenance. So the idea here is that you embed an invisible watermark into the audio or in the video content, and subsequently after it's being circulated, when there's any reports of potentially false video or audio, the content provider can actually take the video, apply some technology to actually get the watermark back to see whether that watermark has been destroyed.
But that's on the content provider side. On the consumer side, the average consumer, how do I know if this source of information is authentic?
I think the best way for consumers to actually verify this is to verify against other online trusted sources of media to see whether this information that is being provided, whether it's real or whether it's fake.
Why can't Facebook and Instagram social media platforms just ban deepfakes?
Given an amount of video or audio content that's being received on social media platforms, I think it's very difficult for these companies to provide a straight-out ban because this will require them to run through and basically check every single source that's being uploaded. And that will require a lot of computational resources, which can be really expensive.
What can be done about it? Is there anything that can be done?
Yeah, definitely. There can definitely be things done about detecting deepfakes. One passive method is to actually use, for example, AI technology or certain physics-based approaches to detect certain deepfake content.
What do you mean by a physics-based approach?
The idea here is that AI generators, at least for today, they don't understand laws of physics. So for example, in certain images or videos, if the light source is actually coming from behind the person, it means that the shadow should be cast in front of the person. But in certain images, the shadow is actually generated at the side of the person, which is inconsistent with the light source. So this is just one example of a physics-based approach that can be used to detect deepfake images or videos.
That's it for this episode on Deepfakes. If you enjoyed it, subscribe and leave us a comment, tell us what you think, and also follow us on Instagram to submit your questions for future episodes. See you next time.